Hello everyone. So in this video, we're going to go over the following research paper titled Ethical Considerations in NLP Shared Tasks. So I haven't read this paper before, so this would be the first time I'm reading it with you guys as well. And this paper is from 2017 and it was published in the proceedings of the first ACL workshop on ethics in NLP. Alright, so let's start with the abstract. So shared tasks are increasingly common in our field. And new challenges are suggested at almost every conference and workshop. However, as this has become an established way of pushing research forward, it is important to discuss how we researchers organize and participate in shared tasks and make that information available to the community to allow further research improvements. In this paper, we present a number of ethical issues along with other areas of concern that are related to the competitive nature of shared tasks. As such issues could potentially impact on research ethics in NLP community. We also propose the development of a framework for the organization of and participation in shared tasks that can help mitigate against these issues arising. So basically they're saying that shared tasks are common. They are common in other fields as well. So they want to establish some ways to further enhance these tasks. And also present some issues which may come up due to the competitive nature of these tasks and which may harm the community in general. So they want to have a look at the research ethics, the impact on the research ethics as well. So let's just read the paper and we'll get a better idea. So shared tasks are competitions to which researchers or teams of researchers submit systems that address specific predefined challenges. Alright, so let's just highlight this. The competitive nature of shared tasks arises from the publication of a system ranking in which the authors of the system receiving the highest scores obtain public acknowledgement of their work. So probably the Olympics just happened. So this is just something like that. So the person who gets the best performance gets the most fame and recognition. So in this paper, we discuss a number of ethical issues and various other areas of concern that relate to the competitive nature of shared tasks. We then move to propose the creation of a common framework for shared tasks that could help in overcoming these issues. So since there is a ranking, then obviously people will try to compete. They will not want to share their ideas. They might want to preserve ideas for further competitions. So that is what I guess they meant by this could potentially harm the community. So the primary goal of shared tasks is to encourage wider international participation in solving particular tasks at hand. A second objective is to learn from the competing systems so that research can move forward from one year to the next or to establish best practices as to how to tackle a particular challenge. So for instance, if you have two models, one of them is giving a good fluency while another is giving good accuracy, then you can learn from both the models and probably work out a third model which might incorporate both of them, sort of maybe an ensemble of both of them. So over the past few years, the organization and participation in shared tasks has become more popular in NLP, speech and image processing. In the field of NLP study, researchers now have an array of annual tasks in which they can participate. For example, several shared tasks are organized in the Conference of Natural Language Learning, the Conference and Labs of the Evaluation Forum, or the International Workshop on Semantic Evaluation. So all of these are very famous conferences. So for those working on a topic that proves to be particularly challenging, it has become a trend to propose a new shared task co-located at a related conference or workshop in order to encourage contributions from the wider community to address the problem at hand. So basically, if someone is, say, getting stuck at how to increase the generate good quality counter narratives, then they can propose that as a shared task and then people can pitch in their ideas and compete. So that recognition is something which may make people strive more. Alright, the NLP community has seen a rapid increase in the number of shared tasks recently, with many repeated periodically while others are being organized only once. So during all co-located workshops at ACL 2016 alone, a total of 9 new shared tasks were proposed, along with other held annually. The 2016 Conference on Machine Translation, for instance, offered 6 shared tasks already held in previous years, along with 4 new ones. Since this paper is old, I'm really interested in seeing what these statistics are now at. So I'll try to look them up as well, but probably not in the video. A distinctive feature of shared tasks is their integral competitive nature, as I discussed. In the field of research ethics, the factor of competition in research projects has been shown to potentially negative ethical consequences for upholding research integrity and the open character of scientific research. So I guess this is pretty obvious why people might use underhanded techniques, or people might not do work in the spirit of research, rather in the spirit of winning competitions. For instance, McCain 1991 has argued that increased competition for funding and publications in the field of genetics has resulted in undesirable secretive behavior of scientists, of refusal to provide access to datasets, or conflicts about ownership of experimental material, right? So suppose someone spent a lot of time on building a dataset, then they would not want to share it so that they can keep using it in different research works. They might be scared that suppose they let it out and they are working on Project X and they know that Project Y is also a possible consequence, but they might just be scared that someone else would do Project Y before them. So additionally, Mumford and Helton 2001 argued that the negative perception among researchers of the intentions of their competitors might invoke unethical behavior. These are serious consequences of elements of competition on the work of researchers. However, to date, little attention seems to have been paid to preventing these problems from arising in the organization of shared tasks in NLP research. So now we have a pretty good idea on what the paper is trying to do. Alright. So with the experience gathered in our community, thanks to the organization of shared tasks over the past 30 years, we believe the time is right to initiate an open discussion on a common ethical framework for the organization of shared tasks, in order to reduce the potential negative ethical consequences of the competitive behavior. Right. So such discussions should be held in the spirit of trying to globally establish a research community which ethical issues should be tackled and considered across all shared tasks. The purpose of this paper is not to criticize how any particular shared task is or has been organized thus far in the field. The remainder of this paper is organized as follows. Section 2 is devoted to an overview of role of shared tasks in NLP, including their definition, importance, as well as particular issues in the existing shared tasks. Section 3 is devoted to a discussion on the potential negative ethical impacts of the factor of competition that is insufficiently regulated. So I gave some examples for this. And finally, Section 4 proposes steps towards the creation of a common framework for the organization of shared tasks in NLP that assists at overcoming the ethical issues we identify. Alright, so let's have a look at shared tasks in NLP. So as mentioned in section 1, shared tasks are competitions to which researchers or teams of researchers submit systems that address a particular challenge. Right, so in the field of NLP, the first shared tasks were initiated in the United States by NIST in collaboration with DARPA. I forgot the full form for NIST. NIST, United States. National Institutes of Standards and Technology. Alright. Then called Evaluation Campaigns, and which were focused on speech processing and started in 1987. So this has been in the field for a long time. In 1992, new initiatives focused on the field of text understanding under the umbrella of the DARPA TIPSTER program. Since then, researchers in NLP have experienced how this type of benchmarking for NLP tools and systems has become a tradition in many sub-areas. In fact, some of the current annual shared tasks date all the way back to 1998 and 1999, when the first SEM-EVAL, then called SENSE-EVAL 1, and CONEL were organized. All right. So typically, shared tasks consist of four distinct phases: training, dry run, evaluation, and adjudication. So during the training phase, participants are provided with data to calibrate their systems. They are then used to process a blind test set during the dry run, and their results are evaluated against a gold standard prepared by the shared tasks organizer. So gold standard is the target outcome. So suppose if there is a sentence and you have to predict whether it is hate speech or not, then the gold standard will be the ground truth label. So the annotators would have decided, okay, this sentence is hate speech, and then the model will predict whether it thinks it is hate speech or not. So why are shared tasks important in our field? Shared tasks are important because they help boost the pace of development in our field and encourage a culture of improving upon the state of the art. True. Shared tasks have an additional advantage. By using the same data, all systems can be evaluated objectively and comparisons across systems should be made easier. At the same time, some best practices and de facto standards have evolved from shared tasks. Example, the widely used Cornell format used in parsing and many other NLP tasks, and the splitting of German compounds in machine translation proposed by Cohen and Knight 2003. Alright, so they're saying that due to these shared tasks, these new ideas came to light. A byproduct of these shared tasks are the new datasets that are made available for the use by wider research community. Shared tasks encourage the development of new resources and also encourage innovative approaches to data collection. Moreover, provided the data is made available, any researcher can measure the performance of their system against past shared task data. It is also possible for any researcher outside one shared task to use the publicly available shared task data after the event to benchmark new system or application and allow for replication or experiments. So, example, MATE tools development reported evaluations based on a dataset from the Cornell 2009 shared task. So, basically, what they're saying is that suppose some researcher is working on a different topic, but they can still use shared task data for a different topic to benchmark their work. So, that I guess one example would be zero shot learning. So, zero shot learning is something like this where you don't train the model on that type of data, but then you try to predict the class. So for example, this. Suppose you train the model on these classes only, but then you show the model these classes to predict. All right. So where were we? Right. Shared tasks with a large number of participants can also indicate the need to tackle a particular problem or point to challenges that are particularly attractive for NLP research community. The participation of industry-based teams in shared tasks shows that some of the relevant some of them are relevant beyond the academic research community. So you can see these huge companies also have research teams. For instance, Microsoft Research or Google Brain, which are heavily invested in developing new research technologies. So taken together, shared tasks have proven themselves to be effective in incentivizing research in specialized areas because they come with rewards and recognition, but they come at a cost. Organizers need to prepare the datasets well in advance, define the evaluation criteria, gather enough interest, rank the submitted systems, and so on. At the same time, there is little information sharing among shared tasks that would allow organizers to benefit from the experience of others. As a result, shared tasks vary greatly in the way they are organized, how the datasets are shared, and the type of information which is available to participants and the research community both before, during, and after the evaluation. So basically what they're saying is a lot of work comes from the organizer side as well, and there is also limited flow of information, so not everything is shared with everyone, and that is where the secrecy part also comes into play. So variability across shared tasks. So depending on the task at hand, shared tasks are organized in different ways. So in some cases, such as the empty shared task, no annotated data is needed and thus only aligned bilingual data is used. In other, prior to the shared task, the organizers create annotated data that will be distributed to all participating teams to allow them to prepare, and is used with two main aims. So to adjust to the format required for submission and allowing researchers to explore the data to develop automatic systems, either rule-based or machine learning-based, so that they are able to perform on unseen data. So this is a use of data. First of all, you will get to know what sort of submission is expected. So is it a binary class or what exactly do they want? And then of course you need to train the model with some data, right? That is where it comes into play. In some cases, the shared task organizers will distinguish between two different tracks for the same shared task, depending on the source of data being used to train the system. In most cases, all teams in an evaluation test their system on the same data set to allow for easier across the board comparison. Other shared tasks allow for the inclusion of additional data by individual teams. So that is open track and the prior was closed track. In these open tracks, the inclusion of other data is not necessarily verified and based on a trust system. It is worth noting that to date this system has worked well, and to the best of our knowledge, there have been no known issues of mistrust in NLP shared tasks. Alright, so that's good to hear. Depending on the type of shared tasks, different evaluation methodologies will be used, ranging from purely automatic metrics such as precision and recall for many of the shared focusing on information retrieval to human evaluation for machine translation outputs. So some are very easy to do. For instance, like I was talking about hate speech classification. For that, you don't really need human evaluation once you have the annotated data. But for something like machine translation, you need a human evaluation as well. So like potential ethical issues concerning the competitive nature of shared tasks. So this is section 3 now. As we have seen in the previous section, there is currently a great variability and a lack of standardization in the organization of shared tasks. Because shared tasks have become an important part of the scientific research in NLP, a certain level of standardization is nonetheless required in order to safeguard satisfactory levels of scientific integrity and openness of scientific research. This standardization in the organization of shared tasks is needed specifically to mitigate potential negative ethical impacts of their competitive character. With a view to proposing a standard approach to shared task organization, in this section, we discuss the potential negative ethical impacts of competing in scientific research and subsequently illustrate this by addressing potentially problematic aspects of the organization of shared tasks in NLP. So we've seen the different problems, like we've seen different points and why shared tasks are used and what good they bring. But now let's look at the potential issues which come up with shared tasks, and there is also the lack of standardization in the organization. So these are also some points. So ethical issues, competition is a factor in scientific research that is not limited to NLP. In the organization of contemporary science, competitive schemes for scientific positions publications are there. However, shared tasks are distinctive, such as because the elements of competition is integral to research activity. In other words, shared tasks not only take place within a competitive context, they are competitions per se. Yep. So not only are people competing, but they are also being ranked at the same time. I guess that is what they mean. For this reason, the effects of competition on the conduct of researchers should be taken seriously. So as argued in this book or paper, I'm not sure, the relationship between competition and academic misconduct is a serious concern. A number of negative ethical impacts of competition in scientific research are discussed in the literature. So we suggest NLP community could draw and present three important observations. So secretive behavior, the effect of competition is that researchers tend hide their work so that they have some unfair competitive advantage on the challenge at hand. So McCain suggested that this behavior can have several concrete forms, such as unwillingness to publish research results in a timely fashion, refusal to provide access to data sets, and conflict concerning the ownership of experimental material. Right, so if a research lab has created a data set which can improve the performance on a shared task, they would not be willing to share it beforehand. Overlook the relevance of ethical concerns. Another effect of competition is that tendency of the teams competing to overlook the relevance of the ethical concern. So as discussed, they might disregard ethical concerns in general, specifically with regard to one's own work, while anticipating the potential ethical misconduct of others. If we can do it, why shouldn't we? This can lead to careless or questionable research conduct. So I guess this is pretty self-explanatory. Relation with other scientists, because the stakes in competitions can be very high, they might result in further or decreased research funding or in opening up or closing off of future career paths. So a lot is at stake. So competitions might have negative impact on research between peers, on the relationship between peers. This might lead researchers to have tendency to behave unethically with regard to their peers in order to preserve or strengthen their reputation. All right. So potential negative impacts of competition in shared tasks in NLP. So the motivation for involvement in shared tasks has evolved somewhat over the years. Many researchers in machine translation will participate in annual tasks where there is a ranking of the best system. Participation and success in tasks such as these are often used to demonstrate research excellence to funding agencies. Of course, funding is very important. At the same time, performance of these systems may also have a greater impact on the funding for a complete research area, not only for individual teams or institutions. We only need to look back to the notorious ALPAC report, whose consequences for research funding in the US for machine translation were devastating for a considerable period. Such funding-related motivation can in turn lead to increased competitiveness. I'm not sure what is this ALPAC report. ALPAC report gained notoriety for being very skeptical of research done in machine translation and emphasizing the need for basic research in computer linguistics. This eventually caused the US government to reduce its funding dramatically. All right. When we revisit the shared tasks within NLP, the potential negative ethical impacts of competition identified in the literature on research ethics can also be found. Here we discuss the main issues identified which require mechanisms to be established by a community to prevent them from happening. So secretiveness, competitiveness can sometimes lead to secretiveness with respect to specific features used to tune a system to ensure that the best methods stay within the same institutions. So participants usually submit their system description to a shared task in the form of a presentation and research paper. However, the way in which such systems are described may vary greatly. So some might just give a high-level description. Oh, so we use transformers and we use these many layers, but they won't go into specific details of how they trained it. So unconscious overlooking of ethical concerns. Leading on from the secretiveness is issues raised above, teams may unintentionally be vague in reporting details of system parameters and functionality solely on the basis that other teams also previously reported in this way. Such practice can simply arise from existence of convention in the absence of guideline or standard. So if one team starts such a bad practice, then people will just follow it saying, oh, they did it, so why can't we? So potential conflicts of interest. Finally, another potential ethical issue is related to organizers or annotators being allowed to participate in the shared task. So again, when some find it unethical to participate in their own shared task, others disagree and the community trusts that in these cases, the organizers trained the system under the same condition. They did not take advantage of prior access to data and did not train the system for a longer period of time or have a sneak peek or hand select for optimal performance or test data to improve their system's performance and cause it to be highly ranked. Okay, so of course these concerns will come into play because that guy really literally has the entire data set at hand. They also know what they'll be tested on. So both point of view are perfectly valid and in some cases even justified. So teams working on low resource languages for which they themselves are one of the few potential participants. When the overlap of organizer and written participants has not yet revealed itself to be a major issue, the goodwill and ethical conduct of all involved is generally trusted. It is worth considering the establishment of methods for minimizing the risk of this happening. One such measure would be for the organizer to explicitly state whether the overlap is likely to happen. Right. So the organizers can tell whether they will be participating or not. So subsequently, we have identified a number of potential conflicts with the objectivity and integrity of research that may arise. So whether intentional or unintentional, these issues are worth considering when developing a common framework for the organization of and participation in these tasks. So lack of description of negative results. The fact that negative results are also informative is something that no researcher will deny because you know what does not work. So however, as shown by Fanelli, researchers have a tendency to report only positive results. He claims that this may be because it attracts more interest and journal editors and peer reviewers might tend to favor them, which will further increase the desirability of a positive outcome to researchers. Furthermore, PhD students being pressed to publish in top conferences in their fields, they may be reluctant to submit systems that do not report on positive results. As a result, while we always discover what worked, we are not usually told what did not work. Although that may be of greater or equal importance because someone in the future might waste a lot of time working on something which did not work with others earlier, and if they had simply told others about it, then it would have saved a lot of time. In fact, it may be the case that the same approach that has been tested by different institutions with no success, and that we are incurring a hidden redundancy that does not help us to move forward as a field. In order to prevent these issues from occurring, we should design mechanisms that incentivize the publication of negative results. Similarly, it may be the case that although it is highly desirable that industry-based teams participate in a shared task, some may be reluctant to do so on the basis of negative impact that may have for their product if it does not end up among the first rank. Thus, rather than strengthening the academia-industry relationship, the learning gap bridges and the gap widens. And basically, what they're trying to say is, suppose some team, there's some Alright, so I just got lost for a second. Suppose we have industry-based teams, then they will not participate because they might not be sure that would they be winning or not. So that would hamper the relation between academy and industry. They would not be competing with each other. They would not be sharing information with each other. So should we not address this and establish mechanisms that encourage industrial teams to participate? So withdrawal. Some teams may prefer to withdraw from the competition rather than participate if they fear that their performance may have a negative impact in their future funding. So how could research excellence on a particular topic be argued if once team comes last in a competition? True. So when they'll be asking for funding, it's usually some person who does not even know what's going on with the field who will be signing the documents. So they might question. Again, mechanism could be designed with the aim of discouraging withdrawal. For example, one possible solution would be to report only the upper 50% of the ranks. So then they could potentially argue that we did not come last, we were just not in the top half. Potential gaming the system. Another concern is the impact of results of the shared task beyond the shared task. Alright, so shared tasks are evaluated against a common test set under the auspices of a fair comparison among systems. However, as the ultimate goal of most participating teams is to obtain the highest position and then to focus on winning rather than the task. Of course, accurate evaluation is crucial when reporting the results of NLP tasks. As evaluation metric plays a crucial role in determining who is the winner of a shared task, many participant teams will tune their systems so that they achieve the highest possible score for the objective function at hand. Alright, as opposed to focusing on whether the approach is actually the best way to solve the problem. This in turn impacts directly on the real world application for which solving the problem challenge is particularly relevant. So they might be winning, but they are not actually solving the problem. So basically, suppose someone is measuring the blue score, then they might use some kind of technique so that the blue score is maximized, but it not actually but like the output might not actually be an improvement or a significant improvement as much as the blue score will show. As discussed previously, some shared tasks allow for closed and open variants. That is, in the closed subtask, participants use only the data provided by the organizer, and so the player field is leveled. And for open, teams are permitted to add extra data. So if we ignore for now the question as to whether the leading team really is the best system for the task at hand or merely has the best pre-processing component, for instance. Alright, so basically they're saying that they are not focusing on this part while looking at close-up tasks. So redundancy and replicability in the field. Another important issue is that although this should be the overriding goal, we typically find that for any new dataset, even for the same language pair, optimal parameter settings established in the previous task do not necessarily carry over to the new, albeit related challenge. This is a real problem. As if this is the case, we should ask ourselves what we as a field are really learning. At the same time, our field experience a lot of redundancy as we try to re-implement others' algorithms against which we test our own system. This is the case particularly when systems participating in a shared task are not subsequently related to the community. So basically, when a new data set comes up, sometimes the top performing model of the previous shared task of the same topic performs poorly on that new data set. So that brings up the question, did the previous model really learn something in things of that sort? Unequal playing field. Another potential issue is that larger teams have greater processing power, so they have better research centers, and this may give an unfair advantage, rendering the competition is unequal. This could be mitigated against by establishing beforehand the conditions under which the system are trained, so they can limit only these many GPUs can be used or only this much VRAM can be used. In this section, we have identified several potential ethical concerns. So as observed, these are the three major concerns. In addition, we have highlighted some other areas of potential ethical consideration. And now for future discussion, the great value of shared tasks is that for all to see, is there for all to see. And there is no doubt that they will continue to be a major venue for many researchers. Nonetheless, we have pointed out several ethical concerns, of course. At the same time, there may be other ethical considerations that the authors have omitted due to lack of knowledge about all shared tasks in NLP, or simply because they arose within participation specific shared tasks and have never been shared with the community. Thus, we see that this as a first step toward determining potential ethical issues All right. Such a survey to be launched shortly after discussion at the 2017 Ethics and NLP workshop consists of two parts. The first tried to gauge the varying requirement of shared tasks, and the second one aims to assessing people what people feel are important factors for considering when drawing up a common framework. This common framework will ensure greater transparency and understanding of shared tasks in our community. So I really love reading such papers because they give us historical perspective. So this must now already be in place, so I can just go out and look up what really happened in this conference. So questions regarding past experiences related to shared tasks are included in the survey to gather information requiring best practices use, the type of information that is available to participants before, during and after, potential ethical concerns encountered in the past and how they tackled it, other causes for concern, good experiences that we should aim at replicating. Besides recommendation best practice, we envisage the creation of a shared task checklist based on the questions in the survey and their replies. These checklists would target the organizers, annotators and participating teams in shared in information to state any in shared tasks and would be used to state any relevant information required in each case. By subsequently making them publicly available to the community, any participating team can interested in the shared task would know how specific topics were addressed in the shared task and what information was or will be available to them. What follows is a non-exhaustive list of some of them. So participants of organizers in the shared task, so like among the organizers who are participating, people who had prior access like annotators or dataset collectors, public release of the results of the participant system after the shared task, so how will the result be released, declaration of the list of contributors, so will they be anonymized and so on and so forth, so all of this. And then this is extending as they told in the start. So the conclusion. In the paper, we have discussed a number of potential ethical issues. Besides taking into account particular features of shared tasks, we investigated the potential ethical issues of competition in scientific research and extrapolated such issues to be potential problems that may arise in our own field. In addition, as we believe this should be tackled by the NLP community as a whole, we have proposed the launch of a survey to gather further information about shared tasks in NLP. This would include current best practices and so on, which they've discussed. Finally, shared tasks in a field play an essential role. They have undoubtedly helped improve the quality of the systems we develop across a range of NLP subfields to a point where many of them comprise essential components of professional workflows. So many of them have come up from shared tasks. The system as such is not irretrievably broken, so there may be temptation to not fix the issues outlined in the paper. However, we firmly believe that the field of NLP has reached a level of maturity where some reflection on the practices that we currently take for granted is merited, such that our shared tasks become ever more reliable and consistent across our discipline, and further strides are made to the benefit of the community as a whole, as well as to the wider community, of course. So this was a very interesting paper, first of all, because this was not a math-heavy paper. Rather, there was no math at all. This was a purely social-oriented paper, like a social sciences kind of paper, where they discussed the ethical consequences, etc. So again, this paper was picked from the NLP for Social Good GitHub repository, which I had showed in a previous video, and I'll link it in the description. If I do not, just remind me, but I'll try to. And the authors have thanked the following organizations in the acknowledgement. So thank you guys for watching. Please like, share and subscribe and comment down below the videos which you papers which you would want me to read as well. And I feel that this is a great way for both of us to learn. So thank you guys for tuning in. Hope to see you next time.